I've made a ton of color grading tutorials on the channel and plan to make a whole lot more, but one question that I've always gotten is, why don't you ever use the color grading scopes in your tutorials? Well, let's find out. Hey guys, Jordy here for CineCam.net, and I'm gonna start with a thank you to Asus, today's sponsor, for sending me their brand new PA32UC monitor. Now, this is a professional reference monitor. It has a whopping 1,000:1 contrast ratio. It comes with a white color gamut that provides all of these color spaces right here. And if you're not editing in a dark room, then the 1,000 nit brightness will definitely come in handy. As a reference, the average monitor sits around at 400 to 500 nits. HDR, built-in LUTs, and that list continues. It has been pre-calibrated in the factory under a DLTE of 2. Now, honestly, I didn't know what that was either, but I learned from Potato Jet, who did a complete guide about this monitor, that a Delta E under 2 is like crazy good. The monitor also comes with an X-Rite calibrator tool, which you can use to calibrate your monitor in the future, or maybe calibrate your old monitor. Anyways, as you can hear, I'm super pumped up by this monitor. It does come with a price tag, but if you're serious about color correction and grading, then it's definitely a monitor worth looking at. You can follow the first link in the description below to learn more, and I'm also going to leave a link to Potato Jet's video. Now, why don't I use the scopes? Well, as we all know, color correction or color grading is the process of changing the exposure levels and colors to fix your shots or to achieve a creative look that helps you tell your story. And the way that I see it is that you have two kinds of projects. The first one are the hub projects, and these are things like vlogs, quick travel videos, or even a client who only gives you one day to edit. You don't have the time to fine-tune every single detail. And if we talk about video scopes, it's going to take a little bit more time than if we would just apply a global color grading over our shots. But then there are the hero projects. You know, the short film that you're working on, the commercial video that you really need to fine-tune in every detail. And here it's best that you don't apply one color grading to everything, but take a look at each individual shot and use the video scopes to measure your adjustments. So I never really wanted to bother anyone with the scopes, as I've always tried to explain how to make a creative look. But okay, let's get technical. Inside Adobe Premiere Pro, we can go up to the menu, window, and from there choose Ulumetri Scopes. Now, this is a tool that can help you during the color grading process to measure the exposure levels, colors, and saturation. It's like going outside to feel for yourself whether or not that you should put on a jacket before you leave the house. You kind of guess what the temperature is, and you make a decision based off from that. But you can also measure the temperature. You don't even need to go outside for that. It is way more precise than guessing how warm it is outside, but did you ever decide to take your jacket with you or not based off the temperature number? I don't think so. You just quickly open the door and you just kind of feel for yourself whether or not that you should put on your jacket. And it's kind of the same with color grading. You don't look at your scopes and do your entire color grading like that. No, you look at your monitor, decide whether or not your color grading looks good based off what you see and not what you measure. Now, any colorist watching right now probably wants to shoot me, because professional editors and definitely colorists do rely heavily on those scopes. So then, what's the deal here? Well, let's first have a look at what the scopes actually do. There are two kinds of scopes that I want to take a look at in this video, and we're going to start off with the waveform. Right-click in your scopes and choose Waveform Luma. If you right-click again, you can disable the other scopes if you like. You can have up to 4 different scopes open in here. Now, what's currently in my timeline is just a simple tile from black to white and some gray variations in between. When looking at the waveform, we can already see the same shape coming back. The left side of the waveform is also the left side of my clip, so this perfectly represents my shot. The middle gray bars are also the middle of the waveform. On the bottom of the waveform, we can find the blacks, and on top, the whites, and everything else falls in between. On the bottom, we can find 0, which is absolute black, and on top is 100, which is absolute white. It's the same as percentage, but we use the fancy term IRE, which stands for Institute of Radio Engineers, which probably makes no sense at all, but it are those guys who came up with it. Anyways, we talk about 0 IRE when something is pitch black. We can also see it right here at the first black bar. If you want to know at which exposure level that the third bar lays, I can just look it up into my waveform and see that it sits around 45 IRE. Alright, we get it. Let's bring a real shot into Premiere Pro. a beautiful rock of some kind of a volcano, I think. Anyways, I want to find out where the brightness level of that rock sits. So I start looking at the middle of the waveform, and there are kind of two levels right here, a brighter and a darker. And when looking at my shot, that is normal because the sky above the rock is brighter. The rock itself is the darkest, and the grass underneath is a little bit brighter. So this tells me that around the 10 IRE, I can find my rock, and the sky above the rock sits around 60 IRE. So that is how we can read the waveform. We've got a lot of room. We are not coming close to 0 or 100 IRE, so let's increase the exposure for this shot. To my eyes now, it seems like this is the maximum that I can go before I crush the sky in the back. But here's the interesting part. The waveform tells me that there is still a little bit of space. Of course, we don't want to push the highlights against the 100 IRE line because that will overexpose the shot. But we can increase it a little bit more to go around 98 IRE. So there's that first advantage of using these scopes. With the ASUS monitor, I can judge my shots pretty close, but if you are using a monitor that is not so great or not calibrated, your first guess might be completely wrong. Where you think that a shot is already overexposed, it might only be at 90 IRE. And the same thing goes about colors, which we'll dive in later. Now, this does not mean that we should always take up the entire space. When I color correct this shot to utilize the entire contrast, it is definitely not wrong, but from a creative choice, it might be too much contrast. So let's have a look at the next example. These here are two shots of an old radio, a long shot and a close-up. We want to create a low contrast, washed out look. So what I'm gonna do is bring up the blacks and aim them around 10% or 10 IRE. As for the whites, let's bring that down so that the maximum is 80 IRE. To make the close-up match with the other one, I can use these scopes to also push the blacks up to 10 IRE and the whites down to 80 IRE. So that is the super basics of the waveform and how it works, but we've only been talking about the exposure so far. In the next example, let's have a look at colors and skin tones. Here we've got a breakfast scene with a lot of contrast and colors. From the Lumetri scopes, I'm going to right-click and choose Vector Scope YUV. The vector scope resembles the color wheel, and the white are the colors within that color wheel, which come back in our shots. The further they peak, the more saturated the colors are. And we can see that very good when I increase the saturation. So, like with the waveform, we can already understand that this tool can help us to match different saturation levels. But that's not all. We can also use the vector scope to get the skin tones right. For this, we're going to have to isolate them. I'm going to create a mask around a portion of the skin tones, and this will only show that part of the clip on the vector scope. What I can tell now is that the skin tones are too red, and I can see that because this line right here between the red and the yellow represents the skin tones, and our highlight should be on that. So let me do some color corrections to bring that highlight onto the skin tones line. When we now remove the mask and look at the before and the after, we can straight away see that the skin tones look a lot better. Here's another great example on how to use the vector scope. You want to create this teal and orange look, so with the color wheel, you just kind of push teal or blue into the shadows to make them deeper and stronger. But this will offset the rest of the colors, so you're gonna have to compensate with orange in the midtones. But look what happens at the vector scope. All your colors are being pushed around, and when I enable that mask again, you can see that the skin tones are not correct anymore. So I make sure that when I add orange in my midtones, I pay attention to the vector scope and aim the highlights into the skin tones line. And this will give me a clean teal and orange look without having the actors look like pumpkins. And that's the super basics of how you can use that vector scope. And there's a lot more that these tools can help us with, but I'm gonna leave it with these basics for now. If you would like to see more content about these video scopes, then definitely let us know in the comments below. I really hope that you guys enjoyed this video. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you, ASUS, for the gorgeous monitor. And like always, stay creative.
It's Creative Tuesday, and we're currently making the photo for Instagram.
Come on, Jordy, be beautiful.
I am beautiful.
This is the most ridiculous shoot I ever seen.
I feel like one of those Instagram girls.